And how does the session go? Like, what do you, what can a person expect out of a session?
So in the session, we start with, it's called somatic, but it's not physical. It doesn't involve any touch. The client sits down, usually can lie down, but most of the time sits down. And we establish what we want to work on. And as I mentioned, it can be very specific and it can be very open. But our body and our subconscious mind will pick up of what we wanting to address. It can just be the way I feel right now. So usually we start with like closing our eyes and checking, how do I feel right now? How do I feel right now in my body? And suddenly the person starts with, oh, my heart's actually racing really fast, or I feel pressure on my back, or mm-hmm. I feel tension in my hands. So it's usually these little things in our body. That's what we start to work with. Or when we start talking about a specific thing, so like, oh, I always fight with my husband, yeah? So again, we feel into that situation. There's always a physical sensation into our body. So we go into this sensation, we visit it, the energetic charge in our body, where it's actually stored. And then when it gets overwhelming, or when we're there for a specific amount of time, we regulate. So we go back into our ventral. So it can be just feeling a part of your body which feels calm, relaxed. It can be anything. It can be your legs, but it can also be your nose. Just some parts of the body usually don't experience the activation. So when I go there, my attention goes there. My system thinks we are safe. So my system okay. regulates. But as it regulates, it releases a little charge from the place we visited. So we wow. keep releasing slowly. Then of course, there might be a need for a certain move sometimes. Yeah, at some point the client might feel, I really need to do this move, or I need to shout. It's usually something what we needed to do in that moment, but for whatever reason we couldn't. But the body still remembers that when the doctor came with the injection, I wanted to push him away. It was dark in the room and I was scared. I wanted to scream, but I couldn't for whatever reason. So we let our body to finish the move, because it can be there 40 years and the body still wants to finish the move.
Wow.
So sometimes it can be that. We do it very slowly so that the system can pick up on it and can know it's done and completed. It can be a noise. Again, we can only imagine doing that noise. You don't need to necessarily scream. It's enough to imagine you really, really screaming. Sometimes it might take us into a story. So I might see some things. For people who are visual, they might see an image. Yeah, they might see a stone somewhere which they need to throw away. Or they might see something on their body. Is something's lying here and they actually feel like they can take it off and they can throw it somewhere really far. So if you visual, it might be a visual thing which appears in front of our eyes. It can be the real thing. I can actually see my mom leaving the room and I'm scared. It can even show as a fairy tale or as a story. Yeah. It can be different characters who I'm dealing with in that process. And they making things right. Sometimes what we can do, that's a little bit different method. We revisit the situation, we can give it a different ending. Because if we revisit, we are actually in that energetic charge. And my system, my brain, develops only one way how to deal with the situation. Because my brain doesn't know, literally does not know another way. It's almost like if you're looking at Google Maps and you want to go from this place to another, the Google Maps will only show you based on the paths which are there. So even if I'm here and I need to go here, but the Google Maps only thinks we need to go like this, the Google Maps will tell me go like this. It will never tell me go like that. Because it doesn't know it's possible. So the brain functions exactly the same way. So if you rewrite the situation, so we imagine that moment that I called my mommy back and I said, mommy, don't leave. I don't want you to go. I'm scared, for example. Mm-hmm. Suddenly I create more options in my brain how I can address the situation in that moment. So when the situation happens again, suddenly I have a choice. Do I leave Do I talk to the person? I suddenly have options. Suddenly it's possible not to act on like an autopilot.
So instead of storing it in as a trauma, so now I say, okay, mommy told me that she's gonna go and get something and then come back. And then mommy leaves in the end. But then in my head, it was like, I still felt safe because I believed that she was coming back instead of believing she wasn't coming back and it's going to hurt me. So is it like that?
Well, in that moment, what we do, if we revisit the situation, so first we're releasing the charge, of course, of the fear I was experiencing, but then we ask that person in that age, so let's say this happened to me when I was 3. In that moment, we're really revisiting the 3-year-old Russia in that moment. Like, what did she want in that moment? What would have been the very ideal situation? And it can be very different. You really start to think as a 3-year-old child. So you're saying, well, but the most I would want now is my mom to sit next to me and read me a book, because this is what I need. So we recreate the situation that this is what happened. This changes the pathways in our brain that when this person leaves, they leave and that's it. I'm here alone. I don't know if they come back. I'm abandoned. You know, it creates this. And all I can do is to shut down. So anytime I feel someone left me, abandoned me, didn't reply my message, my partner left me, I go into shutdown. Mm. So all I can do is like, you know, not talk, not say anything, not express what I actually wanted. My nervous system goes back into the same behavior. But if I could say back then something and create something else, it gives me more freedom now to act on the situation. Well, first of all, I will stop kind of attracting them. But even if they happen, because someone's not replying me, I'm okay with calling them. Yeah. I can actually not go in my shutdown, which I'm not, I don't mind even know I'm going in my shutdown. But it's become so automatically and so instinctively. And I usually have a rational explanation. Well, if he's like that, well, I explain it to myself rationally. I justify the action of my nervous system and I move on. But I don't actually move on. You know, I usually stay in my dysregulation.
The belief states and the energy stays stuck. It doesn't flow out. So it stays there.
So basically, we try to release the charge from that situation, might be conscious or not. If the situation comes back, we can rewrite the story. We can complete the move, which was there, the sound. And usually we end up back in fully regulated state. And that usually shows that you kind of come back. Usually often people don't know how long they were in the process. It feels like 10 minutes, but usually it's an hour. Mm. And when they come back, it's usually they suddenly feel their body. They feel like, oh, actually, I'm a bit tired today. Actually, I'm a bit hungry. Suddenly they are more aware of their body, of the room. Suddenly like, oh, you have a nice painting on the wall, which they never noticed before. Because why? Because you go into your ventral, which means you go into the present moment. So you're aware of yourself and of your surrounding and of your senses. So suddenly you kind of like, you're really here. So you're like, you have, it smells nice here, these flowers, you're present. So that's how we know we release and we came back into our safe state, into our regulation.
Wow, so powerful. And do people have to come back to you? How many sessions do you think a person would need? Do you leave it up to them to decide? Like, you know, you did a session today, go home, see how you feel. And then now that you're more self-aware, you'll be able to decide when you come back to me, or do you give them like a protocol to follow?
So again, this depends. So normally somatic experiencing, you usually come to sessions once in 2 weeks. Because the system needs quite some time to integrate what has changed. The energy of my system changes, so we need to adjust, we need to integrate. So it's not something you can do daily. We usually say after 2-3 weeks. If a client comes with one specific issue, just this one thing I want to address, it can be a few sessions. But if someone is living in a dysregulated state and there's lots of stored traumas and beliefs, and we are so used to living in this regulation, it can take a longer time. I personally, when I discovered somatic experiencing, I did my own therapy for 3 years, just for the sake to see what can come up, what can come up, what can come up. And there's always something what can come up. We store incredible amount of blocks in our system.
I can totally relate to that. And you practiced it on your own by yourself, or did you have to go to a practitioner?
So originally for some years I had a practitioner. Now I can work with myself as well, but I do enjoy if there's someone guiding the process for me, for sure. Of course, like a regulating exercise is something what we can do completely by ourselves.
I get that a lot from practitioners with different modalities. And even myself, I practice energy healing. And it's one thing to do the practice on your own. You know the tools, you know the process. But then, like you said, you let go and you totally kind of surrender more when there is somebody holding that space for you, guiding you. And then you're just doing the work instead of being both the practitioner and the client, you know, you're not playing two roles anymore.
Exactly. So some things like self-regulation and stuff, we can for sure do on ourselves, especially when we find out what brings us back into regulation, that can become our daily practice or our practice after each time I feel like, oh, I'm a little bit dysregulated right now. So I would almost say that's our responsibility to do so, because it doesn't only affect us and our health and our well-being, but also others around us. If you're always angry or agitated or in a state like whatever, I don't care, of course it affects people around me. So that's for sure something we can do ourselves. And once it becomes a routine for us or something automatic, it's actually very simple, because it can just be, you know, listening to some music, or it can be going for a walk. You know, it can be like little things. It can be like, I know that when I sit more than 4 hours in front of my computer, I get really dysregulated. I get kind of like disconnected from myself and I get stressed. So knowing that, instead of sitting 8 hours in front of my computer and then coming off and being impossible to do any other stuff for the rest of the day because I get so dysregulated that it's too late. Every 2 hours, I can do a 5-minute walk, or I can go water my plants, or I can go and be with my pet for a moment, or anything what brings me into regulation. It can be different for people. And also, we need to understand when we dysregulate it, we often tend to either numb that feeling, or we tend to like override it with something, because the way we feel when we disregard it is definitely not pleasant, because it can be agitation, it can be anger, it can be self-doubt, it can be feeling of everything is meaningless, you know, it can show in different ways. So of course we don't want to be in this state. So often what people do, they might have their own ways to deal with it. It can be a form of addiction. It can be, I will eat a sweet in that moment. I will smoke a cigarette. I will have a glass of wine. I will be excessively on Instagram. And of course, it can go to, you know, being an alcoholic or being a drug addict.
More destructive behavior, more exactly. Towards the self and the health, yeah.
So when we self-regulating, we need to make sure we're not numbing, we are actually regulating. There's a difference. And the main aspect that is different is I'm doing it consciously. Like, I know I'm dysregulated now. My instinct is to open my fridge and eat anything I find. But I'll be like, okay, but am I actually hungry? No.
Exactly. Self-awareness. I think it starts and ends. This is from my personal experience with self-awareness. So, Lucy, can you tell us, are there specific conditions or symptoms that the body will show you that your central nervous system is not regulated, you're not working out of regulation? How does it show and how does it come up? And does it necessarily have to be a chronic condition, or is it like instant?
First of all, yes, absolutely. Like, our body would show if our nervous system is in dysregulation. It might be a little bit different if we are more in the sympathetic, which means in our fight and flight mode. That's where we are activated all the time. So this might show as a high blood pressure. This might show as excessive sweating. This might show as heart disease, because there's a lot of pressure on our hearts to function. And it's generally things to, we release lots of adrenaline and cortisol. So it can be like adrenal stress. And often it's also linked to the microbiome, so the digestion. When we are more in the dorsal, it's more like a shutdown. So usually this affects the immune system. This affects also the stomach. It's more linked to obesity, for example, and low blood pressure.
Wow.
And then when there's trauma stored in our body for a long time, which means our nervous system is dysregulated a lot, because our bodies can self-heal, right? If they're in the right state, if they're regulated, they can usually self-heal most of the things. So if the trauma is there and it's not dealt with, after a certain time, it can show as in a form of various symptoms, and often they can be chronic. So just to state some, this is from Peter Levin book, Healing Trauma. So it's based on a lot of research which was done. Is the symptoms which can appear are, for example, the chronic fatigue or a very low physical energy. It can be immune system problems, endocrine problems, thyroid malfunction, psychosomatic illnesses, headache, migraines, neck and back pains. It can be chronic pain. It can be asthma. It can be various skin disorders, digestive problems, and of course, depressions and feelings like that. But it can also be severe premenstrual syndromes. So yeah, it definitely does show in the physical form, especially if it's undealt with, it can become chronic.
So your body will tell you in so many different ways, at so many different points, hey, listen to me, you need to do something about it. There is a process that your body will go through and then give you alerts, warning signs.
Absolutely. So this doesn't happen straight away. The body will start with subtle messages. It may just be not being able to sleep well one night, you know, or being a little bit more stressed or a little bit not present. And then it builds up and it builds up and it builds up. Of course, if I'm always in the sympathetic and I keep releasing adrenaline, for example, so first it might show as a form of agitation. But if my body is producing this hormone for years, of course, it will affect my heart and my blood pressure and my sleeping patterns and so many other things. So the longer we don't address these subtle messages from our body, the more severe can the symptoms get.
You said as a child, these energies get stuck in our body, like you said, when we are growing up, when we're children. And as a child, we didn't process it properly. If I was a parent and I had a kid, and I mean, you as a parent and you have your kids, how do you teach them to process things in the moment so that they don't get these energies stuck as often as anybody else who goes in life unaware would?
Yes, that's a very good question. So there's many aspects to it. So first of all, if our child gets dysregulated, yeah, and they do all the time, yeah, one thing which is important is let whatever wave of energy or emotion comes with that situation for it to be released, because it passed. Sometimes when you watch kids, they fight over a toy, and you feel like, oh, you need to really step in, but they fight, and then one snatches it and the other just like shouts, or, you know, might even like snap, but next second they just move on and they don't even think about it anymore. It's very fast with them. So they complete the action. I get angry, I shout, or I might start crying, you know, or I just do like a little move. But the moment I completed, the activated energy kind of leaves my system. So we let them go through the emotion until it passes. So we don't tell them, stop shouting, stop crying, and there's nothing to cry about or nothing happened. For them, it did. Otherwise, they wouldn't get activated. The nervous system detected a threat, and the nervous system needs to go through activation back to regulation.
So children have the ability to do that without you having to teach them. That's what you're saying.
We are born with this. Our nervous system is meant to experience threats and go back to regulation. So now our nervous system is many, many, many millions years old. So of course we would know there will be threats. Someone might chase us, a dangerous animal might be after us. So our nervous system knows very well how to go into activation and go back into regulation, just like the animals do. Of course, if everything's going well, traumatization can of course happen from a very early age, and then we start losing this ability. It's not that we lose the ability, it's more like we are so stuck in certain state that it's difficult for our nervous system to pendulate. It's called pendulation. Anything what happens for the children needs to stay, needs to come back into a state of safety. So whatever happens, it's okay as long as it ends up as I'm back to safe. Even if a child cries for something a lot, but eventually you hug them and they kind of, whew, okay. And you see, it's like, oh, okay, I'm safe and I'm with my mommy. But if it kind of gets unresolved or they get stuck in like a little shock or a little fear or a little anger, that then usually it gets stored. The children kind of, their nervous system copies our nervous system. So if we as parents or adults around the kids can self-regulate well, so there's an activating situation, and the child kind of observes on a very deep level, on the nervous system level, how does the parent react to it? How do they react to, I don't know, let's say a thunder hits my garden and something is broken. Yeah. So the child instinctively looks like, what's happening now? They don't really know, right? So they kind of unconsciously watch the adult person. So if I be like, oh, okay, oh no, this happened, so let me deal with this. Okay, it's good, nothing actually happened. Whew, back to calm, back to regulated. They learn like, oh, okay, something can happen. The nervous system kind of copies, but we go back to calm. But if I get all over it and I start running around frantically and calling people and doing this and being stressed and angry, and eventually I don't really go back to calm, the nervous system picks up on it and they tend to behave in the same way. So it's the imitation they do, but it's also the way they process their own things which they are going through. And then there's of course like the general feeling of safety. Yes. So like most of the day I feel safe, my mom is around, my dad is around, everything's calm, I get my food, there's no loud noise, there's no shouting, fighting. So that's usually when we are in a very regulated state and we grow up quite regulated. But if there's always chaos around me, if there's always parents shouting, parents fighting, nobody's at home, I'm always alone, of course, it becomes like the state we are in. So it's, I would say, it's the main three things. It's the general feeling of safe, the way the parents deal with dysregulation, regulation, and if I am given the chance to process my emotion, to let the activation kind of pass. So let the activation happen, let me shout, let me cry, because it goes. With children, it actually goes very fast. Knowing all of these things, all of this stuff, it still shocked me how fast it goes. At one point, they shout so much that I think it's the end of the world, and next minute they're playing and they're happy. And I'm like, wow, how did that happen? You know, wow. Because we as adults take much longer when we get very activated to go to fully calm. So they say it takes about 15 minutes to go from sympathetic to ventral, and it takes 30 minutes to go from dorsal to ventral, if we actually working on that.
Very, very powerful. I'm very grateful for these tools you gave me. I noticed that when my child, she is agitated and I let her be, I just watch her and then I go give her a hug, instantly there's a shift in her face, her reaction, her aura, everything. I came to that realization by chance, but then now that you say it, makes so much sense. And then just now putting things into perspective, thank you so much for that.
That actually brings me to another point. We should never judge the emotions of the child, because if they cry or if they do any kind of reaction to something and we say, oh, don't do this, oh, this is bad, there's nothing to cry about, next time they will shut it down. So next time they will not cry, which means next time they will not release. And we might not even know anymore that they would want to cry in that moment, but they don't anymore, right? So if we let our child be, and eventually we hug them, like you said, so you validate whatever they had to go through. It's what you did was what you had to do. And I'm validating your feelings. I understand you got angry. I understand you got sad. It makes sense to me. It might not, but you validate that for them. And then you go back to say, I'm still here. I'm still here. Even if you get dysregulated, I'm still here. It's okay. So that also teaches our nervous system that it's safe for me to go through the wave of activation. So I don't hold it in. And because I will go back to regulation, and I learned that this is a safe and correct thing to do, and I don't feel shame or guilt. Because of course, as we grow up, these reactions take a different form. Mm. Yeah, I will not always have a tantrum as a child, of course. But at a certain age, maybe it's a necessary way to cope with that situation.
Very good. Thank you so much. I mean, I was looking for a tool for adults. Now we got a tool for adults and a tool for adults to use on their kids. Thank you so much, Lucy. Any final words? Anything else you would like to add?
If everyone takes a couple of seconds, 5 times a day, just to check on themselves, like, how do I feel now in my body? Am I activated? And I can do something about that. We can really, and go back into regulation, we can really stop accumulating things over the day. We can be more aware of our energy, of our reactions, of our behavior, of our responses, and we become more in control of how we feel and how we are. It's not that I am the victim of my nervous system, more like the nervous system works for me. It just shows me clues which I can consciously address and approach and deal with. It's a tool for us. It's not our boss who's like trying to, you know, destroy our lives. Quite the opposite. It works for us. So if we acknowledge it for what it is and work with it consciously, we can actually change our lives. And of course, if there's lots of trauma stored in the body, it's good to find a way to deal with this. And there's several ways to deal with that. But somatic work is one of them.
Thank you so much for this. Lucy, if anybody who's watching or listening wants to get in touch with you, can you tell us what's the easiest way to do that?
I have a website. It's called luciaaviana.com. I'm on Instagram on by_LU_CIA. Yeah, I think that would be the two main ways to get in touch. And I live in Dubai. Yeah.
Thank you so, so, so much for your time. I learned so much today through you, and I'm sure everybody who's watching and listening got so many gems from this episode. After this episode, now I'm going to go and check in with my central nervous system, and I'm going to do that exercise and take a few minutes for myself. Thanks for that reminder. Thank you, Lucy, for your time.
Thank you, Rasha. It was really a pleasure.
Thank you for tuning in to this episode. We hope you found it insightful and you enjoyed it as much as we did creating it. Don't forget to like and subscribe for more content like this. Let's continue creating this amazing community of holistic wellness seekers and practitioners together. See you in the next one.